Well, all I could say is thank you. That's probably the world's largest understatement. It is an honor and a privilege to be back in Chile. I have spent many, many memorable visits here, and I have learned a tremendous amount from the experiences that I've had here. I mean, the opportunity to be able to spend time with people like Norbo, who is not just a colleague, but in many ways a mentor to me in the early stages of my career, Mario, Martin, Brigitte. I mean, these are people who have been friends and colleagues, and the relationships have been incredibly gratifying at the personal level and tremendously productive at the academic and biomedical research level. So thank you for having me back again. And yes, I will be returning many times. It is particularly a pleasure to be able to celebrate 5 years of an institute under Martin Montesinos' leadership, because in such a short period of time, when we look at the timeline of science, the contributions have really been transformative. And in many areas, biomedical research, you're looking not just at a single series of contributions, but contributions that have been pursued collaboratively and have been integrative in terms of tying areas of research together. Investigation that has bridged pursuit of fundamental mechanisms and insight into a series of very clinically relevant problems. And that's important in terms of advancing biomedical research forward, but it is also equally important from the perspective of the training that's provided, because you look at the number of postdoctoral fellows and graduate students in the institute, and these are people who are making contributions, but have now the experience, the perspective, and the credentials to be able to go on and to make contributions independently. So all of that in 5 years is something that the institution should be very proud of. And for me to be able to watch this emerge over such a short period of time has been just incredibly gratifying to see. So for all of these reasons, thank you very much for the opportunity to be able to spend time with you folks again. What I wanted to try to do in the next 45 minutes or so is not to give you a detailed accounting of a series of regulatory mechanisms that are involved in epigenetic control, but what I wanted to do, can people hear me now? Okay, so this way I could see what's on the screen, and then what I'll be saying has some credibility to it. So what I wanted to talk about is an approach and a perspective that we've had for a number of years, and that is really two different dimensions of regulation that come together. One is the fact that both genetic and epigenetic control are very critical for understanding biological regulation and changes that take place in cancer and other disorders as well. And I think that's becoming increasingly evident throughout science and medicine. But what I learned through my training in pathology, as I learned really working for Renato Bezerra, was I learned more than about cell cycle control from him, but he was chairman of the pathology department. And what I realized early on, what I was taught from the surgical and the anatomical pathologists, is that you can diagnose cancer, you can assess the treatment of cancer by looking at the shape of a cell, looking at morphology, by trying to understand not just what are the biochemical changes, but how do you organize the regulatory components of a cell within a nucleus, and how does that begin to fall apart with disease, and how do you put it back together? In other words, a cell is not simply a biochemical inventory of regulatory molecules, but the way in which you organize them within a cell is very critical, again, in terms of understanding biology and pathology. So that's the reason that we became very fascinated and very committed to looking at the architectural organization of regulatory molecules. And I'm going to try to give you an idea over the next 45 minutes of how you can look at a cell, how you can analyze a cell, and draw cues from the way that regulatory machinery is organized and compartmentalized into processes, and then how these can be applied to diagnosis and treatment. But the most important thing I want to share with you is that the work I'll be talking about represents a long-standing collaboration with Jane, Janet, Andre, Martine, and Kaleem. And the work I'll be talking about specifically today, the experimental approaches, were designed by very talented graduate students and postdocs. They didn't simply pursue the experiments. And I'm simply reciting to you some of the highlights of the work that they've done. And particularly important, Ricardo Medina comes from Santiago. Rodrigo Grandi comes from Santiago. These are people who are very much involved in the work that I'll be talking about today. Even the original work that was done in our laboratory when I started off as an independent investigator, and that was work that involved cloning the human histone genes to be able to study cell cycle control at the G1S phase cell cycle transition. And that was work that was done by a student I met the first time that I came to Chile. That was Felipe Sierra. So there has been a long-standing professional and personal relationship that is more important to me than words can describe. So what I want to talk about today is how regulatory machinery is organized for biological control, how we retain that information as a cell divides, because we know that genetic information is passed on from parental to progeny cells during cell division, but epigenetic regulation becomes important as well. And why the emphasis on epigenetic regulation? Well, it's becoming clear, both clinically as well as from the standpoint of biological control, that both the onset and progression of cancer is very much linked to changes in DNA encoded information, mutations, but also epigenetic non-DNA encode modifications that are equally important. So we know how DNA encoded information is passed on from parental to progeny cells. And what we've been trying to explore is how, in fact, epigenetic information is passed on from parental to progeny cells during cell division. And maybe I should begin with just a very brief synopsis of some of the parameters of epigenetic control and use that as a segue into the particular approaches that we've been focusing on. So we know that epigenetic control is involved in modifications of DNA. Methylation of DNA is the most prominent one. We know modifications of histones, acetylation, methylation, and phosphorylation, ubiquitination, are very key. These are modifications that are going to affect capacity to express or capacity to be repressed. That's information that has to be retained during cell division for the information to be continually operative. And RNA-mediated gene silencing is a classical example of another dimension to epigenetic control. And non-coding RNAs are becoming increasingly evident as epigenetic mediators. So when we think in terms of regulation of gene expression, DNA encoded information is important, but modifications of histones become important. Non-coding RNAs are very important in terms of regulatory biology and pathology, and all of that information must be mechanistically retained and transmitted with specificity in order for the biological state to be retained and also in order for a disease process to progress. And that makes them very viable druggable targets. I'm going to emphasize a novel dimension to epigenetic control that's beginning to emerge, and one that we played some role in terms of defining, and that is the observation that the factors that control gene expression, the transcription factors, are passed on to parental to progeny cells by being retained with target gene loci on mitotic chromosomes during cell division. And I'll say a little bit how that takes place. But I want to make one more general comment before I share with you the progress of some of these studies. And that is that I made the comment in the title of the talk that what we are looking at is understanding genetic and epigenetic control from an architectural perspective. And what you see here are a series of schematic illustrations of the multiple levels of organization of regulatory machinery within the cell nucleus. And each of these has a series of important regulatory components to it. The architecture gets increasingly complex. And what we are beginning to learn is to be able to mechanistically define how the actual primary structure of DNA is regulated. We're understanding more about how you package DNA into nucleosomes, how you package that into higher order chromatin structures, and now some of what we refer to as higher level nuclear organization, some of these loop domains, intra and inter chromosomal interactions, because what the cell is confronted with is taking 2.5 yards of DNA, packaging it in a structurally and functionally meaningful way within the confines of the cell nucleus. And if that does not take place in a precise manner, biological control becomes compromised. And when in fact it does, if we can understand that in a very precise way, we have increased capabilities to be able to diagnose and treat diseases like cancer, and cancer is really only one example. So the general theme is that all of the regulatory information within a cell nucleus is compartmentalized, not in a series of membrane-bound entities, but is compartmentalized in a very precise way without the use of membranes and through macromolecular interactions. And that's illustrated in these immunofluorescence images, and they are extremely important from a conceptual and from a practical standpoint, because what they show is that every dimension to biological control within a cell nucleus is organized in a very precise way. Look at the sites of transcription. This happens to be the genes that encode ribosomal gene expression. Here's the two nucleoli, two punctate foci. And you're visualizing this not by an overexpression experiment, but simply looking with a light microscope and a fluorescent light microscope. Here's the regulatory machinery for apoptosis. It's punctate. It's compartmentalized. The regulatory machinery for repair, splicing. All of it, the common feature is that it is punctate, it is organized, and there is enough of that macromolecular machinery in a limited number of locations within a nucleus that you can visualize it with a light microscope. And that becomes extremely important. And what is equally important is how, in fact, it gets there in such a precise way and how you remodel that when the cell goes through cell division so that can be retained. Those are very, very fundamental questions that we're just beginning to gain some insight into. So you have all of this type of organization within a cell nucleus. And to give you an idea of the complexity, every one of these regulatory domains is present in exactly this way in every cell. That means that you have to superimpose all these images on top of each other. That's what that composite picture is, what you actually have within the nucleus of a cell, in a normal cell and in a transformed or tumor cell. And these are not static types of subnuclear domains, but they are very dynamic and they respond to changes that take place. And here, if you were to look at one very specific domain within a cell nucleus, and this happens to be the site where the histone genes, these are the genes that encode the histone proteins, are going to be located. You can see the dynamic nature of that process because the DNA replication is confined to 8 hours of the cell cycle, S phase, and it is exactly when that process is initiated that all of the regulatory machinery for histone gene expression comes together at those two sites. That's the two copies of the gene. You know it's come together because you could see the regulatory proteins and the gene co-localized. That's why you see yellow rather than red and green. And as soon as DNA replication is completed at the SG2 junction of the cell cycle, you could see that it falls apart, and now you could see each of them as separate entities. So this indicates in a very vivid way that you have a dynamic process, you put things together, you take them apart, and you do that within the cell nucleus to accommodate a very specific requirement. In this case, it's making histones to package replicating DNA into chromatin. Well, let's reflect back on the fact that I tried to illustrate in a previous slide. You have these multiple levels of nuclear organization. You have DNA structure, chromatin organization. Then you can package into these large loop domains. And then you could package regulatory machinery into these compartments within a nucleus, these microenvironments. Is that simply a phenomenon that is relevant to biological control? Or can we additionally utilize that to be able to diagnose and treat a disease like cancer? And the answer is one can utilize that in a very productive way. And that's what's summarized over here, because if you look at the primary level of genomic organization, that's the basis for your conventional therapy. You're taking primary DNA structure and utilizing it to treat leukemias as well as solid tumors, because intercalating agents are going to be our standards of care for chemotherapy. And there are a number of agents that work in a very similar way. We talked about chromatin organization, and histone deacetylase inhibitors and DNA methylase inhibitors are being utilized as standards of care for treating solid tumors again, as well as liquid tumors. And let's go to the pretty pictures on the previous slide, those microenvironments within the cell nucleus. And if you look at a normal myeloid cell, what you see is a series of 3 to 4 what we call PML bodies, promyelocytic leukemia bodies, which are very important functionally. But a patient who encounters promyelocytic leukemia is going to have 20 to 40 of these promyelocytic leukemia domains. Becomes very important for the pathologist to be able to diagnose promyelocytic leukemia. But PML leukemia is excessively, and that's an appropriate word, excessively responsive to all transretinoic acid. And when the patient goes into remission, you go right back to 3 promyelocytic leukemia bodies. And if the patient is going to relapse, you go back to 15, 20, or 30. So these, I think, are very striking examples of how, in fact, you can already utilize all of the different dimensions of nuclear organization for both genetic and epigenetic control and utilize it with therapeutic effectiveness. So what I want to do is to focus on both the way in which you organize genetic and epigenetic regulatory machinery in an architectural manner. I'll go ahead and show you a couple of schematics that illustrate that, and then talk about some approaches to being able to understand some of that architectural organization from a mechanistic perspective. And I'm going to focus the presentation on one particular set of transcription factors that, like most transcription factors, have a whole series of names. They're called RUNX factors. They're called AML factors. That's acute myelogenous leukemia factors. There's a whole series of other names as well. But the important thing is that this is a family of transcription factors that bind to sites on target gene promoters, and they either activate or they suppress. That's just the beginning of the story, but they also modulate epigenetic control in a very complex and a very meaningful way. So this is an understatement of the complexity of a gene promoter that, in this case, actually happens to encode a tissue-specific gene called osteocalcin. But the point that I wanted to illustrate is that if you take these AML or RUNX transcription factors, they bind to multiple sites on the promoter of that target gene. Three sites that are important. This is the on-off switch region. This is the region that we call an enhancer region. It boosts the level or suppresses the level that the gene is going to be transcribed. But what we tried to illustrate is that these are scaffolding proteins. And what that means is that each of these red RUNX AML factors is going to interact through protein-protein interactions with large cohorts, different cohorts of co-regulatory proteins that are going to support epigenetic control. They're going to bind and strategically localize the enzymology for histone modifications, acetylation, methylation, phosphorylation. These are reversible processes. These are dynamic regulatory events. So they remove those groups as well in response to physiological cues because you have phosphatases and you have D-acetylases and D-methylases. And these are also going to bind the endpoint of a series of signaling pathways, like TGF-beta signaling pathway, like they'll bind steroid hormone receptors. So this is an architectural illustration of a very simple gene promoter and is an understatement of the regulatory complexity that one sees. And this is, I think, a very direct way to say that you, in fact, architecturally organize regulatory machinery along the DNA to be able to support gene expression. But then you take that RUNX AML transcription factor, and this is what you see looking under the microscope. Again, not an overexpression experiment. And here you get about 150 to 300 of these punctate sites. And that tells you that within the nucleus of a cell, you have a defined series of subnuclear domains where that transcription factor is going to be localized. And if you were to do complex proteomic analysis and look at the interactomes, you could see that they are going to link to a whole series of signaling pathways. And the message there is that you don't simply have regulatory information that is localized, but there is a very intricate series of regulatory networks where there's communication between those domains within a nucleus. So this is a community of regulatory factories that are going to work cooperatively and very synergistically to be able to determine what genes are expressed, how a cell is going to respond, and how a cell is going to function. So let's switch from philosophy to some practical biochemistry. How could you begin to mechanistically understand how you actually organize regulatory machinery? We'll focus specifically on that AML RUNX regulatory machinery at those 150 to 300 punctate sites within the cell nucleus. And the approach that we took was to use a classical molecular strategy, and you take the AML transcription factor, and it's got an N-terminus and a C-terminus, and it's been functionally mapped, so we know that towards the N-terminus, what you do at the amino end of the protein, you are going to have a DNA binding domain and a nuclear import signal. So now you've got a signal to recognize a site on the promoter, the multiple sites on the promoter. You've got a signal to get inside the nucleus. How do you actually get from the point of nuclear entry to those punctate sites? So we just simply started deleting from the C-terminus, and we found that when you eliminated the orange domain, all of the protein was present in the nucleus, but none of it formed these punctate sites. And that gave us an indication that you could begin to mechanistically understand how you traffic factors within a nucleus and ultimately localize them to a particular site. And if you simply take that orange 31 amino acids sequence from the RUNX AML factor that's located out towards the end, and you ligate it to Gal4, you could see the same punctate pattern that you find for the wild type protein. It all co-localizes. And that is reasonably compelling evidence that there is a sequence that is sufficient to be able to localize that transcription factor within the nucleus. And these are the consequences. If you eliminate the factor, it's about a 20-fold difference in the level of transcription. So what a biochemist or molecular biologist produces is the type of evidence that I just showed you. What a biologist wants to see is if in a living cell you would find this type of a punctate organization, and if that organization is dependent on that thyroid amino acid sequence. So the approach that we took was simply use time-lapse cinematography. We looked under the microscope as a function of time with a green fluorescent protein lagged AML molecule. And there's your 150 to 300 punctate sites. And you can actually see where they're located. That's over about a 30-minute period. But if you mutate, if you debilitate that C-terminal trafficking signal, all of the protein is there, but now it's smeared all over the nucleus. It's not punctate anymore. Some of it is out in the cytoplasm. And that gave us some increased confidence from a biological type of analysis that there is a mechanism for the subnuclear localization of a regulatory protein. So is there specificity, and can in fact one quantitate subnuclear trafficking? That becomes important, particularly if you want to look at it as potential for drug development. And through a series of collaborations with two very gifted structural biologists, they were able to show that there's a V-shaped structure, it has a flexible glycine hinge, two interaction sites, and that in fact increases the specificity because the amino acid sequences for that subnuclear trafficking signal are unique to the AML transcription factor, not present on other transcription factors. The structure is unique to the AML RUNX transcription factors. And based on the structure, we were then able to introduce single point mutations in the interacting sequences. And now you get a 50-fold difference in the level of transcription. So this provided additional information with respect to architectural determinants for locating regulatory factors within the cell nucleus, because previously we knew that there's a signal that gets you into the nucleus. We knew that there's a DNA binding domain that has promoter recognition, and now we have a nuclear matrix targeting signal that supports intranuclear trafficking. Well, these types of studies were carried out utilizing cell systems, and we had looked at it in several different cell systems, but you always want to get an appreciation for the extent to which this is applicable in a under in vivo conditions in an animal model. So what we then did was looked at two biological processes that the AML factors are involved in. The bone AML factors support bone development, and what we were able to show is that if you mutate the subnuclear trafficking signal, you arrest skeletal development. The hematopoietic AML transcription factor supports myeloid differentiation and is modified in AML leukemia. If in fact you block subnuclear trafficking again with a point mutation, what you do is you inhibit myeloid differentiation and you induce lymphoid transformation. So what this shows is what happens if you look at a knockout, a complete ablation of the AML transcription factor. This is actually work from Komori's group in Japan. And instead of having a skeleton that's bone and cartilage, you have a skeleton which is only cartilage. What we were able to do was to do a gene substitution, a knock-in, where we substituted the AML gene for one that has a mutated subnuclear trafficking signal. And the phenotype is exactly what you see for the knockout animal. So that indicates that the signal is necessary to get the factor to the correct place, and the consequences are a block in development where that gene is actually required. So getting the protein into the nucleus is essential, but equally important, you have to go one step further and get it to the correct place. If you put a single point mutation in the myeloid AML transcription factor, instead of going from a blast cell to a segmented nucleus where you have your differentiated cell, what you do is that point mutation results in retention of the progenitor phenotype, and this is what you find with acute myelogenous leukemia. So with that as a backdrop, we wanted to ask the question, how do you actually retain that regulatory information during mitotic division? Because if you're looking at a normal cell, there's a requirement to have this very complex subnuclear organization during interphase, then the cell goes into mitotic division where you dismantle your nuclear structure, and then 45 minutes later, the two progeny cells emerge with a requirement for transcriptional regulatory machinery to be intact for cell survival. Now, for a cancer cell, you have the same requirements. In order for the cell to sustain malignancy, it has to be able to go ahead to retain that type of nuclear organization and to be able to proliferate exquisitely without the types of controls that you normally expect. So the approach that we took was a very simple one, and that was to follow a cell as it enters and exits mitosis and look at what happens to the AML regulatory machinery. Because you really have to distinguish between two types of models. Either what you do is you degrade the factor, which is what happens to many transcription factors, resynthesize it post-mitotically and put it into place and engage it in regulatory activity, or retain it right through mitotic division. And the easiest way to address that question is to follow a cell during mitosis. And here what you're looking at is right before mitosis, this is the myeloid AML factor, and here is the bone AML RUGS factor. And what was interesting, the first clue, was I mentioned earlier you have 150 to 300 of these punctate domains. That's in exponentially growing cells. But if you synchronize the cells right before cell division, you have 300. And here you could see the 300 that could actually be counted. And here's the cells, here's the progeny cells right after mitotic division. You have 150 in each of the cells. That suggests that you retained it during cell division, or very quickly you reorganized it. But at least you distributed it equivalently to the progeny cells. But when you look directly at a cell right before mitotic division, here's the 300 foci. Look at a cell undergoing mitotic division, and here you could count your 300 foci, and they're associated with the microtubules. That was shown to occur through a microtubule binding domain, but look at the blue chromosomes, and you could actually begin to see that they're present in pairs, but you also have a very defined subset of these transcription foci remaining intact and associated with the mitotic chromosomes. So we then went ahead and looked at a cell right through mitotic division, and there's prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase chromosomes, and the foci remain attached. If you mutate the DNA binding domain, you block the capacity of that transcription factor to interact with its target gene with fidelity, you could see it no longer associates with the mitotic chromosomes. And if you look at a mitotic chromosome spread, where you could actually look at high resolution at a single chromosome, you could see these foci are symmetrically located right on the sister chromatids. And that provided us with real confidence that that focal organization is maintained during mitotic division, and the symmetrical location on the sister chromatids suggests that it is in fact remaining associated with its target genes on mitosis. That was important to us because if in fact we could validate that statement, then you have another dimension to epigenetic control, mitotic bookmarking. So we looked at that a little bit further, and we asked the question in a very direct and unbiased way. The question we asked was, what is expressed, what genes are expressed before cell division that are going to be expressed immediately following resumption of cell division in the progeny cells that would not be expressed if we knock down expression, if we prevent expression of AML? And we were able to identify 40 genes that fit those criteria. That was simply by doing expression profiling. And then we asked the question, how many of those had RUNX AML sites in their promoters? 38 of them had AML sites within their target gene promoters. So we did what's called chromatin immunoprecipitation analysis and verified that the mitotic chromosomes indeed had the AML transcription factor complexed with the target regulatory sites. And that gave us some confidence that, in fact, we have an epigenetic mechanism, and it's justifiable to refer to it as mitotic bookmarking. But what emerged from the expression profiling, which was a total surprise, this was not intuition, this was not a clever hypothesis, it was a surprise observation, and it was that the AML RUNX transcription factors, which remember, transcribe RNA polymerase II transcribed genes, also was bound to the ribosomal genes. And when we went ahead and looked at the metaphase chromosome spreads a little more carefully, we found all five acrocentric chromosomes that have the ribosomal genes on them, that's where the nuclear organizers are located. They each had AML associated with them. In fact, they co-localized with UBF1, the principal co-regulatory protein of RNA polymerase I-mediated transcription. And then when the cell completed mitosis, and you have two progeny cells, and you look at the nucleolus, there is AML and RUNX co-localizing in the region of the nucleolus where transcription is actively taking place. And you could even verify that by immunogold labeling and electron microscopy. So we then went back to molecular approaches and asked if, in fact, you can validate that type of an observation based on molecular organization. And when we looked at the ribosomal gene promoter, we found over 50 AML sites were present. When we did chromatin immunoprecipitation analysis, we found indeed that they occupied the sites. There was a real complex that was present. When we did what we call a rechip analysis with UBF, again, it co-localized. And we're talking now about co-interacting, not just co-localizing by visualization. So combining the microscopy with the molecular biology, we were able to show that both RNA polymerase I and RNA polymerase II genes are, in fact, regulated by the AML RUNX transcription factors. And this simply shows some functional analysis. You could upregulate or downregulate the AML factor, and you get an effect on ribosomal gene expression, but more important, a very profound effect on the capacity of the cell to support protein synthesis. So biologically, this opened another dimension to regulation for us to begin to ponder and explore experimentally, and that is that you have a potential link now between transcription factor control of the cell cycle, because AML controls cell cycle regulatory genes, it controls phenotype, but it also controls cell growth by regulating ribosomal genes. So this is a potential component to coordinate control of cell growth as well as proliferation and phenotype. Well, the obvious question is, most of this work was done with one of the AML transcription factors. Is this true for all of the AML transcription factors? There are three of them. One controls bone, one controls myeloid differentiation. A third deals with GI and neural function. And the answer, in fact, is yes. It controls all three. And in fact, when you look at AML leukemia, where you have a reciprocal translocation of the AML transcription factor, again, what you find is you have control of both cell growth and now the leukemic phenotype. So regulatory factors bookmark or remain associated with a target gene loci during mitosis. That's the DNA, that is a DNA component of regulatory machinery. But I showed you in an earlier slide, you have this logjam of co-regulatory proteins that form regulatory cohorts at multiple sites on target gene promoters. And do you epigenetically only retain the DNA binding protein, or do you retain all or subsets of the co-regulatory proteins? And what is emerging from the addressing that type of a question, you could see here, is that some of the proteins are in fact retained. The co-localization is shown by yellow. Others do not. So it is not an all or none effect. But again, the evidence so far is derived from the AML transcription factors. What about other transcription factors? So we asked the same types of questions that we asked about the AML transcription factors with respect to mitotic retention and with respect to coordinating control of growth and phenotype. For the bone cell lineage, you have the AML RUX transcription factor. For muscle differentiation, you utilize MyoD, and for adipocyte differentiation, you utilize CEBP. And the results of those studies show that indeed both MyoD, CEBP, as well as the AML RUX transcription factors co-regulate ribosomal genes and tissue-specific genes. And the difference is that the interaction with the ribosomal gene promoters, the RNA polymerase 1-driven transcription, is going to, in the case of bone cells, utilize the RUX AML transcription factors. In the case of adipocyte differentiation, you're going to be utilizing CBP. And in the case of muscle differentiation, you have MyoD interacting with UBF, binding to multiple sites on the target gene promoter. So you have a stable component to epigenetic regulation. Is this the type of regulation that occurs under all situations? And the answer appears to be no. And what has recently shown, actually what Rigo Grandi recently showed, is that there are some very striking physiological modifications in this mitotic bookmarking mechanism that is developmentally dependent. And what he looked at was a very unique dimension to epigenetic control that is confined to pluripotency. This is what you see in human embryonic stem cells during the very initial stages of development, prior to lineage commitment, prior to any cell or molecular parameters of differentiation. And what one observes at that time is a phenomenon that is referred to bivalency. And that means that you observe not simply histone modifications that support activation or suppression, but a number of the genes in pluripotent cells have both activation and suppression modifications associated to them. So prior to making any type of a cellular commitment, they retain information, structural information that could have regulatory information for both activation and suppression. What he was able to do was to look at two very specific histone modifications. In this case, he's looking at H3K4, which is an activation modification. And here you're looking at H3K27, which is a suppression modification. And when you look at a pluripotent cell during the cell life cycle, this becomes important because you're watching it prior to, during, and following mitotic division. You're looking at the way in which you either retain or relinquish epigenetic modifications. What he observed was that the suppression modification is going to be constitutive in the pluripotent cell, while the activation modification is present only at one time, and to our surprise, during mitotic division, during the 45 minutes when the chromosomes are condensed. And the genes that exhibit this phenomenon are restricted to the genes that are involved in tissue-specific gene expression. So it appears that this is a mechanism which is poising a gene to be able to go ahead and to be activated in several subsequent divisions. But yet, you're already invoking an epigenetic mechanism and utilizing it in a very selective way. So those are some of the approaches that we've been taking to try to understand how you organize and how you retain epigenetic information. But a lot of that is a work in progress. But what we do have confidence in is that Now we can expand the concept of epigenetic regulation from DNA methylation and histone modifications to looking at bookmarking or transcription factor retention on target gene loci. And that appears to be important for both biological control as well as for cancer. Well, we've been looking at a couple of examples of how the fidelity of organization of regulatory complexes within a nucleus is important for biological processes. How, in fact, can you utilize some of those trafficking mechanisms that are beginning to emerge to be able to potentially modify the activity of a tumor cell? And we took advantage of a longstanding observation that has accumulated from work in a number of laboratories, and that is that metastatic breast and prostate tumor cells express a series of bone proteins. For those of you who understand breast and prostate cancer from a clinical perspective, some of the biomarkers are osteopontin, osteonectin, osteocalcin. You can pick these up as circulating biomarkers. You can identify these if you look at the tumor by histology. And given that we had shown that in a bone cell, these bone proteins are controlled by AML, and given the fact that we were able to show if you perturb correct localization of AML in a bone cell, the fact it cannot exert its activity, we asked if we were to modify the capability of that AML transcription factor to correctly localize in a metastatic breast or prostate cell, can you alleviate some of the catabolic activities of the bone destruction that's caused when a breast or prostate tumor metastasizes to bone? So this is simply to show that if you block expression of AML RUNX in a breast cancer cell, you get a significant decrease in the ability of that tumor to be able to grow and to form an osteolytic lesion. If you upregulate the RUNX AML transcription factor, you get a significant increase in the capacity of that tumor cell to be able to grow and to form an osteolytic lesion. So we did a proof of concept study, and that was to take a breast cancer cell and to introduce it directly into bone and look at what happens over a period of 19 days. And look, you could see the tibia is just about destroyed. I mean, that's about as traumatic an osteolytic lesion that you can imagine forming. If we put two-point mutations in that subnuclear trafficking signal, if we block the ability of that factor to go to the correct place in the nucleus of a breast cancer cell, in 16 out of 20 animals, you can see that the tibia is almost intact. And if you eliminate the whole C-terminus that includes that sequence in 20 out of 20 animals, you have minimal osteolytic consequences of the disease. So that gave us at least some confidence that you have a druggable target that can be utilized in terms of controlling a very key consequence of skeletal metastasis. So let's look at AML leukemia, myeloid leukemia. Let's look at a liquid tumor. And what you find here is the following. This is the AML transcription factor. This is a schematic which I had on the previous slide. Here you could see at the amino end, here's your DNA binding domain, your nuclear import signal. Here's your C-terminal subnuclear trafficking signal. In 17 to 20% of your AML leukemias, what you have is a reciprocal translocation. You cleave the molecule here, you pick up a piece of chromosome 8. This is the translocation fusion protein. It has the correct DNA binding domain, the correct information to enter the nucleus, but you've lost the information to go to the correct site within the nucleus. In fact, you don't lose the ability to go to a subnuclear domain. You pick up a piece of information from chromosome 8 to go to a different subnuclear domain. And the consequences are rather profound. What you end up with is myeloid leukemia and continued proliferation. So we wanted to be able to ask the question whether that was in fact due to a modification in that subnuclear trafficking signal losing its function, as opposed to picking up additional information from the piece from chromosome 8. So we introduced a point mutation into that subnuclear trafficking signal. It's expressed to a very significant extent, almost 3/4 of what you get for the normal type. You now, if you do the biochemistry, you could show it's in a soluble nuclear fraction. It's no longer in the architecturally associated nuclear fraction. And if you then look at the consequences in terms of what genes are expressed, what you do is you block expression of myeloid genes. You expand proliferation of cell cycle regulated genes, and you lose the ability to undergo apoptosis. And this is a clinical description of AML leukemia. If you look at what is happening at the cellular level, instead of proliferating, ceasing to proliferate, forming a very structured nucleus, and then undergoing apoptosis, the cell remains blast-like, continues to proliferate, and you can see significant increased capabilities for colony formation. So again, this is an example where if you remodel the organization, the architectural organization of regulatory machinery in the nucleus, there's a very profound effect on the biology and on the pathology of what the cell is actually going to engage in. So we then turned to asking the question about yet another dimension of epigenetic control, and one which is we're learning a lot more about at a very rapid rate, and that's the role of non-coding RNAs in both biology and in pathology. So first let's look at what's referred to as microRNAs. These are non-coding RNAs. There's a very significantly large array of these, and they are mediators of a whole series of dimensions of control, but there are also significant increases in their expression and decreases in their expression with a series of tumors. And that's been shown by a number of groups, initially by Carlo Croce's group, and confirmed by a number of other laboratories as well. So the question that we wanted to ask is whether there was a direct relationship between transcription factor localization and the actual control of microRNAs. So what we did was took advantage of the observations that I referred to earlier, that there is a requirement for this C-terminal subnuclear trafficking signal for the AML transcription factor to exert biological control. And if you mutate that signal, or if you look at an A21 translocation, you end up with a leukemic phenotype. So the question that we asked with respect to microRNA control was a very direct one, and it was, can we identify non-coding RNAs that are not going to be expressed when you have your wild-type normal AML protein cell, a normal myeloid cell, that will be expressed if you introduce a point mutation into that C-terminal subnuclear trafficking signal and will be expressed equivalently and with equal consequences if you look at an AML leukemic patient who has this A21 chromosomal translocation. So what we did experimentally was simply to screen a series of leukemic patients and look to see a microRNA or group of microRNAs that are expressed in patients that have the A21 translocation. We were able to identify several. We then asked the question, which subset of those will be expressed if you look at cells that have that point mutation in a subnuclear trafficking signal? And the most prominently expressed microRNA was microRNA 23 and 24. So we then went ahead and utilizing a series of target identification algorithms, and this is where we get into the domain of bioinformatics that I can only tell you about but know absolutely nothing about, but I have confidence in it. So they were able to go ahead and to, from bioinformatic analysis, the gene that appeared to be the best candidate was a MAP kinase phosphatase 7. This is a phosphatase that dephosphorylates a MAP kinase, and that MAP kinase is extremely important to support cell proliferation. And when cell proliferation ceases and differentiation is initiated, you need to be able to dephosphorylate with the phosphatase 7. What happens with microRNA 24 to a significant extent, to some extent with microRNA 23, is that the expression is going to block the phosphatase, and the net result is that the kinase remains active, the cell continues to proliferate. The consequences are that now proliferation continues. At the biological level, you have increased colony formation and you've blocked myeloid differentiation. But what is very relevant biologically and clinically is that the cell now becomes cytokine independent and continues to proliferate. So here's an example where you're taking a gene that encodes a microRNA that is involved in cell cycle regulation, required for stringent cell cycle regulation and differentiation. And when the wild type RUNX protein, the normal form of the RUNX protein, binds, the phosphatase is blocked. But when you have the translocation fusion protein bound, because it has the same DNA binding domain, to the promoter of that microRNA 24, now what you end up doing is activating the microRNA that blocks the phosphatase, and proliferation is going to increase and differentiation is going to be compromised. So again, an example of how you can understand how the architectural organization of regulatory machinery, like a transcription factor, could yet impact on another dimension of epigenetic control. The last thing I'm going to show you is that if you take the least understood and at present probably the most puzzling component of nuclear organization, higher order nuclear organization, where you form loop domains with your arrays of nucleosomes, where you have long-range intra-chromosomal interactions, as well as inter-chromosomal interactions, how, in fact, can you actually take a schematic like this and begin to understand if, in fact, there really is an interaction between a region here and here, which is probably what you're looking at is many, many, many stretches of DNA, up to a third to a half of a chromosome. And how about some of the regions of interaction that are occurring within these types of loop domains? And the strategy that we've been using to be able to look at these non-genomic interactions has been an approach which is referred to as chromosome conformation capture. What you do in the laboratory is actually quite simple, and you take an intact cell or an intact nucleus, and you utilize chemical cross-linking, then you cleave with restriction enzymes, and you end up with a series of fragments, and then you ligate the fragments together, and then you do massively parallel sequencing. You sequence everything that you've pulled out over here and look to see what genes and what regions are going to emerge. And these would be regions that were cross-linked, and consequently, they were cross-linked because they were sitting in very close proximity or in contact with each other. And if you do that type of analysis, what you're doing is really a totally unbiased approach to the types of interactions both within and between chromosomes. And you, in fact, can identify a number of interactions utilizing that. We wanted to ask the question, do you find changes in inter and interchromosomal interactions that occur with disease progression? And the model that we utilized was breast cancer. And the initial experiments are carried out in two breast cancer cell lines. This is MCF7, which is an early stage breast cancer cell that is, in fact, hormone responsive. And this is an MCF10A cell, which is a normal breast epithelial cell. And this is the chromosome exhibit simply spelled out on the y-axis and on the x-axis as well, the point being that any one of these dots represents a site of interaction that came from massively parallel sequencing. And if you break out this region here, which is where some of the smaller chromosomes are represented, you're going from large to small chromosomes, you could see that indeed there are changes. You could just see this very superficially, just comparing region for region. And what you see here, here's the MCF7 compared to the 10A. You're looking at it in two colors. If you just break out this region over here, you could see that there are really striking changes that occur throughout. So that tells us yet another dimension to regulation that you could actually begin to understand mechanistically. And why would you be interested in understanding an interchromosomal interaction? Well, if H21 translocations occur in 17 to 20% of your AML leukemias, and translocation occurs in interphase, that simply means that in a cell which is not dividing chromosome 20, that means that chromosome 21 and chromosome 8 must be in proximity. And these approaches show they're not just in proximity, but there are actual contexts. So in conclusion, what I've tried to share with you, how we took a concept like architectural organization of regulatory machinery, which is important for combinatorial control, how you could begin to try to probe mechanistically how you actually organize regulatory machinery at various levels, and a couple of examples which show that despite the fact these approaches are really at their infancy, we're beginning to understand how you can apply information from mechanisms that organize genes and regulatory complexes within a nucleus to better understanding the onset and progression of cancer and a series of targeted therapies. And I gave a couple of examples where we've already have a series of proof of principles that are in place and a couple of examples where they're becoming standards of care. So I'm going to stop here. I want to again thank you for the opportunity for all of us to spend time together. And I welcome the opportunity to answer questions people have. Thank you.